Few sounds in nature are this effective at getting your attention, and few animals evoke the kind of fear in people that rattlesnakes do. But rattlesnakes are not the monsters some would have you believe. They have relatively complex, long lives over which they establish home ranges and learn their surroundings. Though we can't know the mind of a snake, we can use technology to better understand what they do and where they go. After 4 years of intensive field research, we bring you a rare and in-depth look into a year in the life of a timber rattlesnake. You could be forgiven if you don't immediately spot the snake that's coiled right in front of me. But this beautiful timber rattlesnake is sitting here in ambush posture hoping a meal might come along. This is Mr. Darcy. At least that's what we call him, and we've been tracking him now for 3 years. We've learned a lot about what he does year to year. And today, I want to show you what it's like in the life of Mr. Darcy, the timber rattlesnake. Timber rattlesnakes emerge from their long winter slumber among the blooming flowers and warming temperatures of April. Though spring is pleasant for us, this is a dangerous time for a rattlesnake. They are cold, slow, and often emaciated from months without food. Unexpected cold fronts can be fatal for snakes that wander too far from the safety of their den. But an even greater threat to these snakes comes from above. Hawks are one of the few animals that will readily predate an adult timber rattlesnake. And without a canopy of leaves to obscure their view, soaring hawks have a clear view of rattlesnakes emerging from their dens to bask. As a result, rattlesnakes are more cautious during this time and often nestle into thick leaf litter or hide in rotten logs. Both strategies likely offer some insulation from the cold and protection from predators. Typically, we see the healthiest and largest snakes, like Mr. Darcy, emerge the latest. If they have extra energy reserves to wait a bit longer, emerging to bask during early spring is probably not a risk worth taking. Snakes spend the winter underground in cool, damp places, but being in such a humid environment for months on end can lead to minor skin lesions or even allow the potentially deadly snake fungal disease to take hold. But as they grow, rattlesnakes shed their skin, and an early season shed can help begin the healing process or even clear skin blemishes and infections acquired from months spent inactive and underground. After basking for a brief period, they seek out warm, humid locations to shed their skin, often in large hollow logs or wet bottomland forests. The humidity helps loosen their skin and ensures that it comes off in one nice piece without breaking or flaking off. Mr. Darcy seems to wait until early May to emerge, and he often doesn't go through ecdysis until June. Coming out healthy and in warmer weather means he can get right to the important business of finding food. We'll get more into how rattlesnakes hunt in a future video, but for now, let's take a bird's eye view of Mr. Darcy's home range. At this point in his life, he's a seasoned hunter, and Mr. Darcy often gets his first meal in the mixed deciduous forest surrounding his den. Rattlesnakes are ectotherms, meaning their bodies don't really generate as much internal body heat as endotherms or warm-blooded animals. Their body temperature is regulated more by the external environment than their own metabolism. So Mr. Darcy has to move from closed forest canopies to more open environments to heat his body enough to digest a meal. Curiously, he seems to generally prefer open habitats more than other males we've tracked. Maybe success early in life conditioned him to gravitate towards these habitats, or maybe his home range just happened to overlap areas that were slated for timber harvest a decade or so ago. Either way, the dense undergrowth of regenerating vegetation here provides snakes with cover from predators while still letting through plenty of sun to maintain their desired body temperature. Much of Mr. Darcy's summer is spent moving in a broad arc from his den through a patchwork of mature forest and heavily cut over regenerating woods. He covers at least 5 miles during a single year with a core home range of over 300 acres. Today, we find Mr. Darcy coiled in a ravine less than half a mile from his den. Summer is nearly over, and he's starting to slowly make his way back to an overwintering site he's likely used for many years. Though the few hundred meters remaining in his path may be only a moderate hike for us, it's a considerably longer journey for a snake to cover.
It's actually quite remarkable how far these snakes move in a year when we consider the landscape from their perspective.
So there's no snake in here today, but one researcher appropriately dubbed this rock Pimberley Rock, because 3 years ago this is where we first caught Mr. Darcy. And at that time, we thought this was his den. Timber rattlesnakes often den in outcrops like this, but it turns out his den is nearby and is even more interesting.
The exact entry point to Mr. Darcy's den was a mystery for the first year we tracked him, but during our second fall, we had the rare fortune of following him on the exact day and the exact hour that he was returning to his hibernacula. After making his way downhill from where we suspected the entry point must be, he descended into a small rock house using a fallen tree, and then surprised us by entering a large but well-hidden cave. This cave may have served as a hibernacula for many generations of rattlesnakes, and the true significance of places like this can only be appreciated by the snakes which remember its location, and probably first discovered it by following their mother's scent here. The knowledge of such a vital place, passed on generation to generation, is not unlike things important to us in our own culture. Though rattlesnakes and humans are very different, perhaps we share more in common than we know.